Welcome to Bit by Bit, the podcast for equestrians hosted by the Farmhouse Tack Shop. I'm your host, Michelle Drum, e-commerce and marketing director at the Farmhouse. And just like most of you, I'm an active amateur equestrian. Today, we have a special episode for you. We are introducing Bit by Bit 20 Questions, where we ask top riders 20 questions about anything and everything. This week's special guest is Kelli Cruciotti Vanderveen. Let's dive right in and watch me trip my way through my first interview. Thanks for joining me today, Kelli.
Thank you for having me. We're so excited to be here.
Great. And we're at Tryon, so you've been here for 2 weeks?
Yep, we've been here. This is actually our third week now. This is our final week here before our little vacation, so hoping for a big finish tomorrow, Saturday night. But we've had a great circuit, so
we're really happy. So we're going to start off with just quick 20 questions,
because
I know you don't have a whole lot of time.
Yep.
So we're trying to keep this at a minimum.
Yep.
Let's start off with just a few icebreakers.
Sure. So
if you and Gideon were toy figures, what two pieces would you come with?
Oh my gosh, I didn't really play with dolls as kids, so I don't have a lot of, I had ponies instead. I would assume I would be like some kind of Barbie and he would be my horse and we'd have a big barn and there'd have to be plenty of stables.
Of course.
At least 20.
And some turnout.
Turnout, a ring, maybe a trailer. A
couple of jumps.
I think that's more than two items, but I have the whole barn.
When you're schooling at home, do you ride with music?
Sometimes I do. If I'm flatting on my own, I like to have some music in the background. My speed horse in particular, Forever, he loves music. So when you flat him, he has to have his music on.
So you don't use headphones?
No headphones. Just normally on my pocket, and he likes to hear it.
Nice! Yep. What are some of his favorite groups?
Well, he loves the Newsboys. We like our Christian rap.
Nice!
He gets into it. And surprisingly, Cindy said he also is very into Beethoven.
So really?
He's a classical kind of Christian rap kind of guy.
Cool, yeah. That's really cool. What's currently at the top of your playlist? Would you say it's the Newsboys? Or?
Yeah, probably Newsboys or anything by Phil Wickham I love.
Another icebreaker question.
Yep.
If you could ride any horse, still with us or gone, who would it be and why?
I've always said this. I would love to ride Fit for Fun. Used to be ridden by Luciana Denise. I think she took her to the World Equestrian Games. She was amazing. Chestnut mare, my type.
Ginger mare. Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah, spicy,
so yeah. I would definitely love to ride Fit for Fun.
Really cool.
Yep.
If you had to choose between jumpers and Grand Prix or hunters and derbies, which would it be?
Oh, boy. I mean, they're both very fun, but probably Grand Prix.
Yeah?
Yeah, probably.
Yeah. Is there anything in your tack trunk that you cannot leave for show and not have with you?
I have to preface this because it used to be, I had this thing when I was a junior, right before the Devon Grand Prix, I didn't have two pairs of gloves. So I just wore two left ones and I won the class.
Whatever.
So after that, I was like, it's a thing. Like I need two left gloves. And it's not in the typical sense you'd think. I just flipped the other one upside down. So it looked like I actually had two left hands. That quickly myth got debunked when I had a few too many fences down.
Oh.
So I was like, it's the gloves, take them away. So now I try not to rely on too many superstitions or anything, but I'm like any rider. I like my backpack with my setup, my favorite pair of spurs. I'm not a person that likes to switch too many things. So I'm pretty consistent with the things that I like.
What are your favorite pair of spurs?
I actually found them in Europe when we were on our European tour, and I don't know the brand of them, unfortunately. The spur straps are Dion, but the spurs are black on the outside, and they fit my foot perfectly. They're like made for women. So
Are they metal or are they rubber?
They're like rubber on the outside.
Nice.
Yeah, so they fit really nice.
Nice.
So yeah,
very
they're
cool.
new favorite.
Right? Yeah, no, especially don't leave the metal marks
exactly.
on the bottom, so that's really cool.
Yeah.
Thinking back on your riding life,
yep.
Can you tell me about a time you parted company with a horse that you can now look back on and laugh? Like true amateur moment.
I don't think it was a fault of any of ours. My horse of a lifetime was Chamonix H. And the only time I actually ever technically fell off of her was in a jump off at WEF. I think I was last to go on the grass. And I thought I was just nailing it. Like
yeah.
I was on it. And
yeah.
I turned to the last turn and I think I turned too sharp and she just slipped.
Just
out from underneath you. And somehow I was sitting on the ground and she was already thinking, I'm like, I thought we were winning. I don't know what happened. And somehow I'm not winning now. I'm just sitting in the grass. So no fault of either of ours, but that was probably it was a little bit of a mind blower because I was like, I really envisioned through the finish timers, the crowd, thunderous applause, but none of that happened.
Yeah, it's all in your head.
It's all in my head. Yeah.
Like, everybody falls.
Everybody falls.
Just, yeah.
Everybody falls. Yeah.
Even for the dumbest reasons. I mean, it just happens. So it's
it does.
Nice to know that professionals at your level can also reflect back on times when things just didn't go your way.
Yes,
so.
Exactly.
When you get on a horse, a strange horse for the first time,
yep.
what is the first thing that you ask? The owner, rider, caretaker?
Like, oh, sure. Yeah. I love to know history about horses. So like my favorite thing to do in my off time is to scour the internet and know everything about every horse there is possible. Right. Where bridle like, used to go as a four-year-old.
Oh,
or
wow.
So I like to be in the know. So typically before I get on a horse, I probably know more than I should or I'm letting on. So I try to ask questions that aren't too creepy, that I already know the answer to and still act surprised.
Right.
But by I would hope by the time I try to ride them or ride them for the first time, I know a good
kind
amount
of what
about them. Exactly.
Yeah, yeah. At what point in your youth did you realize you wanted, this is what you wanted to do? This was
super
thing.
Early, probably I 7, 8.
Yeah.
I was really fortunate to grow up. Obviously my mom is and still is a trainer, has been for over 45 years. So to grow up with that role model was something I always aspired to be. So even as a young person,
so
I was
sweet.
Like, this is exactly where I want to be.
Do you have any tips or tricks on handling show nerves? Mm-hmm. You're at the in-gate and you're, oh my God. And
I like to envision my course. So like if you can close your eyes and envision yourself doing the course successfully, I think that helps a lot because you can kind of see it. You can see your plan. You can see the finish and then you're like, okay, now execute it. And just thinking about it, less emotion and more like you have a job to do, get the job
What's
done.
Great idea. And just take the emotion
exactly.
out of it. And this is
business. This is what we got to do.
We're business here.
Yeah.
That's a
and then you
great
can have
idea.
The emotion after and everything like that. But I try to just think of it more as a job, get the job done and then celebrate or not
right.
after.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Right. What does an average day look like for you? Either at the horse
average
show or at
day.
Home, your choice.
I mean, probably at the show would be, average day is busy. We start typically no later than probably 6 or 6:30, prepping horses, getting them out. Every horse gets ridden before they show, clients and my own. So that's a busy mornings. And then training and showing myself is always kind of the balancing act of how much I have to show. And then also, it's not all about me. So we got to go to the hunter ring or the equitation ring or whatever it is in between classes. You just have to be really flexible and go with the flow. But I'm really fortunate we have such an amazing staff around us, and between my mom and Kelli Clevenger, we have an amazing team.
That's
wouldn't be
really
possible
cool.
without all three of them.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's a lot.
Yeah.
You've got a lot
it's
of
a lot.
Here.
Yeah.
It's you know, you got to keep the ball rolling.
Exactly.
So can you share an experience in your riding career where you overcame a significant challenge, like you struggled to learn a skill or a concept, and you know, how did you work around it or you know, master?
I used to be absolutely terrible at anything over 8 strides, but 10 was fine. So 9 strides in particular was like, I mean, it was for years. Like I would not do 9. Like I would walk in and be like, I'm doing 8. It's not 8. It's definitely not 8. It's 9.
It's going to end up being 9.
It's going to be 9. And
I just
refused. Yeah, exactly. I refused. I can remember losing classes at Devon because I didn't want to count the 9. And the 10 was beautiful, but it wasn't the right number. And then I thought, well, it's just in the equitation. No, it's also in Grand Prix when you have to do 9 and you refuse to do 9 and it doesn't work out.
It hurts
out.
You.
Yes. It hurts you, yep. So actually, big credit to Cindy, my mom. We just went home and I think for
everything
months,
in the ring was 9
Every
strides.
Single thing was 9.
The bending
yep.
line, the
oh, yeah.
straight line.
Pulls, bending line, straight line, everything until I learned to do 9.
That's
but it was frustrating because it's something that I really struggled with. I feel like a lot of things in my riding have come naturally, but that was not one of them.
Yes.
And I really had to, it was frustrating, but if I didn't address it, it was just going to keep coming up. So it was definitely a test of, you know, perseverance and going home and fixing it.
So what does your post-show care situation look like for your horses? Like Gideon, let's say you finish the Grand Prix,
sure.
we're done, we're going back to the barn. What does his care setup look like?
So again, like extremely fortunate to have amazing staff. His main groom, Martine, always takes care of him. So typically walk him out a little bit after the class, loosen the girth, walk him back. He's a very easy keeper. So some of them that are funny about some things, he loves everything. So he'll go in, we call them the fireman boots. They're up to their knees. He stands in the ice, submerged in water. Typically, sometimes we'll do some compression wraps with those.
Okay.
So compression and ice always go great together. He'll stand in those for about 25 to 30 minutes, get a shower, hoof packing, Epsom salt, and then poultice. I like to do the old racehorse poultice. So, you know, up to the armpits,
yep.
front and back.
Yep.
Looks silly, but I like anytime you have a, you know, top level athlete, you want to draw out any inflammation you can.
Yeah.
And they use their whole body. So.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, they're
and
super
then,
fit. So.
Yeah. Tons of treats, obviously. He's extremely
What's his favorite
spoiled.
Treat?
Oh, he loves everything. He loves bananas probably the most.
Seriously?
Yeah. Loves bananas.
Oh my God. Peel and all or just
him? He wants to peel, but I still can't bring myself to do it. I think it's just gross. So I won't let him.
What do you enjoy doing when you're not at the barn?
My husband would probably differ in this question. I don't rest well for long periods of time. 2-3 days, amazing. So typically when I get home, I like to, like, I call it the hibernate. I don't like to leave the house. So whether it's just, you know, I like to bake. I'm not particularly good at it.
It's okay.
So about 2 days, I'm like, I'm good with baking. No more baking. I just like to spend time with, obviously, my family, friends. We try to go out to some nice dinners and just feel a little bit more normal sometimes.
Right. Yeah.
But no, we like to travel a little bit. And we're fortunate where we live. There's so many cool areas within an hour's distance. So
have you been any place interesting like recently?
A couple years ago, we went to Savannah, which was fun, with a couple group of friends of ours. Yeah. And it was just nice to get away and do something a little bit different. So
beautiful.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
Savannah and Charleston, both are just such classic Southern towns.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, what are your thoughts about alternative therapy modalities like Beamer, acupuncture, chiropractic, deep tissue massage, body work, like all that stuff? Like, do your horses receive them? Do you personally receive
Absolutely.
Any of that?
Yeah, so, we're big believers in anything that can help them feel their best, myself included. I actually see an amazing chiropractor in Florida who's really changed my life, changed my husband's life. And the horses also, Gideon gets, you know, acupuncture, body work, anything that can make him feel his best. We use the Activo Med blanket typically before he jumps. Everything that you can do, obviously, be educated in, know what's happening and what your horse likes and doesn't like, because some horses don't like it.
Yeah.
But every horse is specific, and I feel like he enjoys the finer things in life. So yeah, we also have a theraplate at home, which we really like.
Nice.
And we stand on it too. So right, yeah. I'm always like, I'll hold him, and then I stand on it with him.
From a performance standpoint, what is your go-to riding gear and pieces, and why do you like these pieces so much?
I mean, obviously my go-to is everything area. I think that they're the front runner for me in the sport of pieces that combined function with fashion. They look amazing, but they also feel amazing to ride in. So my favorite combination right now is kind of the Luxe show shirt with the Ravello boot and the Meridian show coat. I think the colors are really beautiful.
Yeah.
I'm a sucker for the blue and the green behind me.
Yeah.
I think it's just fun, but it also sticks with a little bit of tradition. And every year they're coming out with something new, you know, whether the fabrics are a little bit lighter or a little more durable, they're always trying to stay at the top of the game.
To date, what is your favorite moment in your riding career? Favorite win, accolade, clinic, opportunity that you've been given?
I'd have to say, well, there's so many. Like I said, I've been so fortunate to have so many favorite memories. I mean, it's hard to pick from one. Probably, I would say probably winning the Pessoa finals, the equitation finals.
That's a good one.
Just because it was such a culmination of so many years of work with Cindy and I and so many other people that helped, but also with such a special horse with Monterey. He wasn't everybody's horse when we got him.
Right.
He was kind of difficult. He had a reputation of being not so easy. And that day was just so special. I can remember every detail of that day. He was just on it.
He was ready to win.
Exactly. And it's like one of those days that you get described as a rider, like everything is perfect. Like it just, all the stars come into alignment and it's just your day. And I can remember very few days like that except for that one. So that will
really
always
cool.
be a special memory. And then sharing it with my mom at the end was really special.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
What is your favorite horse show venue and why?
I would say Devon always has a special place in my heart.
Yeah.
The crowd there is like nothing you've ever seen. They're so into the sport. They give you like so much energy. And obviously having such an unexpected win makes it my favorite. I definitely didn't expect to win the Grand Prix. It was only the second time I'd ever jumped at that level.
Oh, wow.
And it was just for fun, mostly.
Yeah.
And she just felt the crowd and was like, I'm not listening to you anymore. And we're winning the class. It's true. And even when I made it to the jump off, we were so, I didn't even know the jump off because I didn't think I was going to go clear. And there's a specific moment on the video you can actually hear. And everyone said, why'd you turn so tight to the double? I said, well, if you actually listen to the video, someone in the crowd says turn. And my mare was so spectacular.
That's
she was
awesome.
Like, they're telling me to turn.
It's
and
time to turn.
It was right there. And I was like, yep, perfect timing. So I think Chamonix won the class. I was just along for the ride.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
That's really cool. What is one piece of essential gear for you and your horse that you'd recommend for riders this season?
Probably. I'd say the Ravello boots are really becoming my new favorite tall
boot. Yeah.
They last a long time. I ride, you know, 6 to 8 horses a day at home at the shows, and they always look in perfect condition. They make me feel my best. Probably for my horse. I just like anything that keeps them really comfortable, anything that keeps them happy. Never give them enough treats and, you know, just keep them happy. They do a big job for us. So anything that you can do, and I'm sure everybody has their favorite, you know, saddle pad or half pad or saddle. The saddles we use are great. We use Devaku, and I feel like Gideon has his own saddle and he feels his best jumping in it.
Between shows, when you're homeschooling, is there like a very specific flat work or gymnastic exercise that you like to use at home? I mean, that doesn't have to be like real big or important or anything, but just something that you feel is very beneficial to all of your horses to keep them on their toes or keep them thinking instead of just drilling in the same stuff that us amateurs like to do.
I would say this also gives total credit to Cindy. She is always doing something new. I think we are always having a new course every other day, a new exercise. The typical exercise that we like to do that I find most beneficial is we call it the box exercise. It's just poles. You could do it with jumps if you want, but it's just four poles that make a box, typically one or two strides in between. And then you start building off of that. You do one stride, you do two stride. Then you can do the corners left to left in right to right in one or two. And then if you want to feel like you've mastered that, then you start adding a transition in the middle.
Ooh.
So you canter the pole, walk, switch leads, canter the next pole. It becomes really hard, really fast.
Yes.
If you're feeling confident, just do a transition and then you'll be very humbled.
Wow.
And it really gets them thinking mentally without feeling like they're actually exerting a lot of energy.
That's really cool. That's a great tip. I love that.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for doing this for
us today.
And I really appreciate you coming. And if you guys have any questions or have any comments or have anybody that you'd like to see us interview, please drop it in the comments. We'd love to know. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it.